TATOO Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Starrigger by John DeChancie. Narrated by Rudy, Sanda. 1. I first picked her up on Tau Ceti 2. At least, I'm fairly sure that was the first time. Depends on how you look at it. She was the last in the usual line of star hikers thumbing near the Skyway on-ramp to the Epsilon Eridani aperture. Tall, with short, dark hair, wearing a silver all-climb survival suit that tried to hide her figure but ultimately failed, she was demurely holding her UV parasol up against Tau's eye-narrowing glare, her thumb cocked down road in that timeless gesture. She was smiling irresistibly, confidently, knowing damn well she'd get scooped up by the first male driver whose endocrine system was online that day. Mine was, and she knew that, too. "What do you think?" I asked Sam. He usually had opinions on these matters. "A skyhooker?" He scanned her for a microsecond or two. "Nah, too pretty." "You have some old-fashioned ideas. But then you always did."
"Going to pick her up?"
I braked and started to answer, but as we passed, the smile faded a little, and her eyebrows lowered questioningly, as if she thought she recognized me. The expression was only half completed before we flew past. That made it definite. I braked hard, eased the rig onto the shoulder, pulled to a stop, and waited, watching her through the side view parabolic as she hoofed it up to us.
"Something?" Sam asked.
Don't know. Do you recognize her?"
"Nope."
I rubbed the stubble on my chin. I seem never to be clean-shaven when it counts.
"You figure she's trouble?" "A woman that good-looking is always trouble. And if you think that's an outdated notion, wipe off the backs of your ears and wise up."
I took a deep breath, equalized the cab pressure, and popped the passenger side hatch. Out in the desert, it was quiet, and her approaching footsteps were muffled in the thin air. She was a good distance back, since I usually roar by star hikers to intimidate them. Some tend to get aggressive, pulling cute stunts like stepping right out in front of you and flagging you down. A while back, I smeared one such enterprising gentleman over a half click of road. The colonial cops took my report, told me I was a bad boy, and warned me not to do it again, or at least not on their beat. I heard her puff up to the cab and mount the ladder up the side. Her head popped up above the seat, and a fetching head it was. Dark blue eyes, clear, fair skin, high cheekbones, and general fashion model symmetry. A face you don't see every day. One I'd thought didn't exist, except in the electron-brushed fantasies of glamour photographers. Her makeup was light, but expertly effective. I was sure I'd never seen her before, but what she said was, "I thought it was you." She took off her clear plastic assist mask and shook her head wonderingly. "My God, I never expected." She trailed off and shrugged. "Well, come to think of it, I guess it was inevitable as long as I stayed on the Skyway." She smiled.
I smiled back.
"You like this atmosphere?"
"Huh? Oh, sorry." She climbed in and closed the hatch. "It is kind of thin and ozone-y." She folded up the parasol the rest of the way, struggled out of her combo backpack respirator, and put it between her knees on the deck. Then opened it and stashed the brolly inside. "You should try to stand out there for a couple of hours bareheaded. Trouble is," she pulled up the hood on her suit, "if you wear this, nobody knows what you look like."
"Indeed."
I gunned the engine and pulled onto the ramp. We rode along in silence until we swung out onto the Skyway. I goosed the plasma flow, and soon the rig was clipping along at 100 meters per second or so. Ahead, the Skyway was a black ribbon racing across ochre sand straight toward its vanishing point on the horizon. It would be about an hour's drive to the next set of toll booths. The sky was violet and clear, as it usually was on TC2. I had a pretty woman riding shotgun, and I felt reasonably good about things, even though Sam and I expected trouble on this run. Except for the present puzzle of why she was acting as if we knew each other when I was sure we didn't, everything was cruising along just fine. The way she was looking at me made me a little self-conscious, though, but I waited for her to take the lead. I was playing this one strictly by ear. Finally, she said, "I expected a couple of possible reactions, but silence wasn't one of them." I checked the bow scanners, then gave the con to Sam. He took over the controls and acknowledged. She turned to Sam's eye on the dash and waved. "Hi, Sam," she said. "Long time no see and all that."
"How's it going?" he answered. "Nice to see you again."
Sam knew the tune. I eased the captain chair back and turned sideways on the seat.
"What did you expect?" I asked her.
"Well, first maybe pleasant conversation, then a little acrimony seeping out. From your end, of course."
"Acrimony? From me?"
I frowned.
"Why?"
She was puzzled. "I guess I really don't know." She turned her head slowly and looked out the port, watching the desert roll by. I studied the back of her head. Presently, without looking back, she said, "Weren't you at all put out when I disappeared on you like that?" I thought I detected a note of disappointment, but wasn't sure. Letting about 1,000 meters go by before answering, I said carefully,
"I was, but I got over it. I knew you were a free being. I hoped it sounded good."
Another good stretch of Skyway scooted under us, and I got this out of her. "I missed you. I really did. But I had my reasons for just upping and leaving. I'm sorry if it seemed inconsiderate." She bit her lip and looked at me tentatively, trying to gauge my mood. She didn't get much of a clue and gave it up. "I'm sorry," she said with a little self-deprecating laugh. "I guess inconsiderate doesn't quite cover it. Callous is more like it."
"You never seemed the callous sort," I improvised. "I'm sure your reasons were valid." I put it a bit more archly than I had intended.
"Still, I probably should have written you." She turned her head quickly to me and chuckled. "Except you have no address."
"There's always the guild office."
"Last time I saw your desk, it was a 6-meter-high pile of unanswered mail with legs."
"I've never been a clean desk man. Congenital aversion to paperwork."
"Well, still." She seemed at a loss as to how to proceed with the conversation from that point.
I didn't have the vaguest idea how to help her, so I got up and said I was going to put on some coffee.
She declined the offer. I went into the aft cabin, got the brewer working, then sat at the tiny breakfast nook and thought about it for a good while.
"Seems like we done did us a timer, son," Sam whispered in my ear over the hush circuit. "Or, I should say, we're going to do one."
"Yeah," I mumbled. I was still thinking.
A paradox presents you with few options, or an infinity of them if you look at it another way.
Anyway, I looked at it. I didn't like it. I spent a good while back in the cabin doing that, not liking it. In fact, I didn't realize how long until Sam's voice came over the cabin speaker.
"Toll booth's coming up."
I went back to the cab and buckled myself into the driver's seat. The woman was curled up in one of the rear seats with her eyes closed, but she opened them as I was strapping in. I told her to do the same. She came forward to the shotgun seat and obeyed.
"Got it, Sam," I said. "Give me a closing speed."
112.693 meters per second.
"Check. Let's get some round numbers on the readout and make it easy."
"Can do," Sam said cheerily. Coming up on 115 now. Nope. Little more. Steady. Okay. Locked in. 115 steady.
Right. I could see the toll booths now. Kerr-Tipler objects is what they're formerly called, though there are many names for them. Titanic, dark cylinders thrust up against the sky like an array of impossibly huge grain silos lying along the road, some almost 5 kilometers high.
6 kilometers in closing, Sam said. On track.
Check. Signs were coming up. I signaled for English. Approaching Einstein-Rosenbridge aperture. Portal number 564, Interstellar Route 80 to Epsilon Eridani 1. Danger. Extreme tidal forces. Map ahead. Stop if uncertain. The map, a big oblong of blue-painted metal sticking out of the sand, looked new and obtrusive, as did the road signs, so obviously not an artifact of the ancient race that built the Skyway. The road builders didn't believe in signs or maps. We rolled on toward the aperture. I looked over to check if our passenger had strapped herself in correctly. She had. A veteran of the road. Sam kept reading out our speed as I kept the rig trimmed for entry. Another series of signs came up. Warning. Approaching commit point. Maintain constant speed. Extreme danger. Do not stop beyond commit point.
Right in the slot, Sam said. Everything's green for entry.
Check. The flashing red commit marker shot past, and we were in the middle of a gravitational tug of war between the spinning cylinders of collapsed matter which created the ER bridge. They heaved past, towering black monoliths spaced at various intervals alongside the road, their bases hovering a few centimeters off the crushed earth, all different sizes, invisibly spinning at unimaginable speeds. The trick was to keep your velocity constant so that the cylinders could balance out the conflicting tidal stresses they generated. If you slowed or speeded up, you were in danger of getting a head bounced off the roof or a port. Worse, you could overturn or lose control and go off the road altogether. In either case, there'd be nothing left of you to send back to the folks but some squashed nucleons and a puff of degenerate electron gas, and it's hard to find the right size box for those. At the end of the line of cylinders, there was a patch of fuzzy blackness, a kind of nothing space. We dove into it. And got through. The desert was gone. And we were flying over road that cut through dense green jungle under a low and leaden sky. We had a 500-kilometer stretch until we hit Mach City, where I had planned to stop for a sleeper. Sam took over, and I settled back.
By the way, Sam whispered, her name's Darla. Talked to her a bit while you were brooding aft. Told her I'd been flushed and reprogrammed. Didn't have her name in my banks anymore.
I nodded. So, I said, turning to her, how's life been treating you, Darla? She smiled warmly, and those perfect white teeth brightened up the cab.
Jake, she said. Dear Jake, you're going to think I'm getting even with you for clamming up all that time back there, but I'm beat to hell. Would you mind awfully if I went back and tried to catch up on sleep?
Hell no. Be my guest. That was that.
You stopping at Mach City? We'll talk over dinner, okay?
Sure. She batted long eyelashes at me for a second, flashing her supernova bright grin. But I could see a shadow of uncertainty behind it all, as if she were entertaining doubts about who I was. She was obviously at a loss to explain my strange behavior. It's almost impossible to fake knowing someone when you don't, or, more often, when you've met someone and don't remember. Awkward situations at cocktail parties. But in this case, I definitely knew I had never seen her before. But the doubts were momentary.
She blew me a kiss in one hell of an ingratiating way and went aft. And left me to watch the scenery and ruminate.
Well, buddy?
Sam meant for me to fill in the blank. I don't know. Just don't know, Sam.
She could be a plant.
I considered it. No. Wilkes is subtle enough to concoct a yarn like that, but he wouldn't go to all that bother.
Still,
Sam wasn't sure. She's giving a very convincing performance if she is. I yawned.
I'm going to wink out, too.
I eased back the chair and closed my eyes. I didn't sleep, just thought about times past and time future, about life on the Skyway. I may have dozed off for a few minutes now and then, but there was too much to chew over. Most of what went through my head isn't worth repeating, just the usual road buzz. Anyway, it killed about an hour. Then the sign for Mock City whizzed by, and I took back the controls. 2. Sunny's Motel and Restaurant is just off the road to the Groombridge 34 portal. It's rather luxurious, in an upholstered sewerish kind of way, but the rates are relatively cheap, and the food is good. I pulled into the lot and scrammed the engine. It looked like it was early morning, local time. I woke Darla up and told Sam to mind the store while we tried to get something to eat. The lot was crammed, and I anticipated a long wait for a table. Along with the usual assortment of rigs, there were private ground vehicles in the lot, all makes and models, mostly alien-built. On Skyway, the transportation market had been cornered long ago by a handful of races, at least in this part of the galaxy, and competition was stiff for human outfits trying to wedge in. I paused to look Sam over. We had pulled in next to a rig of Rixian make, a spanking new one with an aerodynamic cowling garishly decaled in gilt filigree. A custom job, a little too showy for my taste, but it made Sam look sick, bedecked as he was in road grime, impact microcraters, a botched original emulsicoat that was coming off in flakes around his stabilizer foils, and a few dents here and there. His left front roller sported crystallization patches all over, its variable traction capacity just about shot. I'd been collecting spot inspection tags on it for a good while, had a charming nosegay of them by now, courtesy of the Colonial Militia, with the promise of more lovelies yet to come. They do brighten up a glove box. We went into the restaurant, and sure enough, there was a god-awful long wait. Darla and I didn't have much to say while we waited. Too many people about. I was almost ready to leave when the robo-hostess came for us and showed us to a booth by the window, my favorite spot in any beanery. Things were looking up until I spotted Wilkes with a few of his assistants in a far corner. They had an alien with them, a Reticulan, a snatch-ganger, if I knew my Reticulans. Ricky-tickies like humans especially. We have such sensitive nerve endings, you know, and scream most satisfactorily. If he had been alone, I knew it was a male because his pheromones reached across the room, hitting my nose as a faint whiff of turpentine and almonds, he wouldn't have lasted 2 minutes here or anywhere on any human world. They are free to travel the Skyway, as is any race, but they are not welcome off-road in the Terran maze, nor are they loved in many other regions of the galaxy. But he was with Corey Wilkes, undoubtedly on business, which afforded him some immunity. Nobody was looking at them but me and Darla. Wilkes caught sight of me, smiled, and waved as if we were at a church picnic. I gave him my best tooth flash and stuck my nose in the menu.
What are you having, Darla? It's on me.
Let me buy you dinner once. I've been working lately.
This is breakfast.
After a moment, I took the opportunity to ask, what have you been doing?
For the last month, waitressing to keep body and soul together. Before that, singing, as usual. Saloons, nightclubs. I had a really good group behind me, lots of gigs. But they threw me over for a new chanteuse. Kept my arrangements and left me with the motel tab on Gazaibu 3.
Nice.
The waiter came, and we ordered. There were a few other aliens in the place. A beta hydron was slurping something viscous in the next booth with a human companion. Most restaurants on Skyway cater to alien trade, and that includes alien road facilities with regard to human customers. But the air of resentment against the Reticulan was palpable. I looked around for familiar faces. Besides Wilkes, I spied Red Shaughnessy over in the corner with his partner, Pavel Korolenko. Shaughnessy winked at me. Red was vice president of TATOO once, but came over to us when he had had enough of Wilkes. Some guild members still distrusted him, but he had been a big help in the early days of the guild's struggle. The fight wasn't over yet. We were still trying to wean drivers away from Wilkes when it was easier and safer for them to keep their mouths glued to TATOO's bloated tit. I also saw Gil Tommaso and Sugin Chang, but they weren't looking in my direction. They were well off their usual route. A special run. Looking around again, I thought I saw a familiar face at a table near Wilkes and Company. A tall, thin, patrician gentleman with a mane of white hair, but I couldn't place him. I had the feeling I knew his face from the news feeds. Probably a middle to upper level authority bureaucrat on an inspection junket. By the time the food came, the edge had come off my appetite. If I had had any sense, I would have walked out at the first sight of Wilkes, and no one would have blamed me. But there's a primal territoriality in us all. Why should I leave? Why not him? Red got up and came over. I introduced him to Darla, and I thought I caught a speck of recognition in his eyes. He declined a cup of sour bean, a native brew that tastes nothing like coffee and faintly like a mixture of cinnamon and iodine. He lit one of his nasty-looking cigars.
"Trouble, Jake," he said. "Trouble all over the star slab."
I picked at my eggs Eridani. "This I know. Anything new?"
"Marty DeFlippo."
"What about her?"
"Just came over the skyband. She hit the toll booths on Barnard's 2.
That hurt. I had known Marty well. A good woman. Good driver. She could pilot a rig better than most, always on schedule, always with a smile. She had been one of the handful of charter members the Starriggers Guild could claim. I looked out the window for a moment. I had a flashing fantasy of getting lost in the riotous vegetation out there, rooting somewhere in the moist jungle earth. No more joy or sorrow, just light and water and peace. I looked back at Red. "What are the cops saying? Any witnesses?" "There is no other evidence available when the cylinders swallow a person. In fact, the question was stupid, as there is no other way to prove that it happened at all. Every year, travelers set off on Skyway and are never seen again. Hundreds of them."
"There was a rig behind her when it happened," Red told me. "Said her left rear roller went out of sync on her just as she hit the commit marker. She couldn't straighten up in time, and that was that."
"Who reported it?"
"Didn't get his name. A TATOO driver, for sure, but not one of Wilkes's torpedoes. Just an average guy. Probably had nothing to do with it."
Red took a long pull of his cigar.
"It could have been an accident."
"Hell of an inconvenient time for a sink loss," I said, putting down my fork. There was no chance of my eating. Darla, however, was digging in, seemingly oblivious to our conversation. Or very convenient, depending on your point of view. I considered a possibility, then said, "We've never had witnesses before. disappearances, no clues.
How's this? A small, smokeless charge set on the traction sink delegate. The box is easily accessible, if you've ever looked. Detonated by remote control or by a gravitational stress-sensitive fuse.
Sounds plausible, Red said. I'd go for the fuse idea, though I've never heard of one like that. The driver was treated for flash burns and gamma shine exposure.
So? Verisimilitude.
Yeah. I see what you mean about the delegate switcher. I'd never have thought of doing it that way. Seems to me, if you wanted to send a rig out of control on cue, you'd booby-trap the pulse transformer, or something even more basic.
Sure, but the hardware's harder to get to. Besides, all you'd be doing would be to send the rollers to their frictional base states, and they become like super slippery bald tires. Pretty hairy when you're taking a sharp curve, but on a straightaway it's really no problem. But knocking out the delegate switcher on a portal approach could be fatal. The rollers would go independent for a fraction of a second as they each go through their friction curves from base state to maximum traction until the backups cut in. I've heard of it happening. The rig goes into a dangerous fishtail, which in normal circumstances can be corrected by a good driver. But on a portal approach...
Red nodded.
I see.
That's why the driver thought it was the left rear. The rig probably swung its ass end to the right. But in fact, it was all the front drive rollers coming to the peak of their grab factor curves before the back ones did. The wind probably determined the direction of the spin, or some other factor. Red shrugged deferentially.
You make a good case, Jake. But we'll never know.
I know. I've been with Marty, seen her navigate a portal approach with 3 bad rollers and an 80-click-per-hour crosswind. There wasn't much that she couldn't handle, except what I suggested.
Red nodded.
Now that I had won my case, I wished someone would argue me out of it. But both Red and I knew I was right. Accidents among guild drivers were increasing, as was vandalism. Nobody was getting beaten up. That wasn't Wilkes' style.
You got to remember, Jake, Red said to break the depressed mood. We're still behind you. I don't know of anybody who wants to pack it in and go back to Wilkes. But if anything were to happen to you, well, merd.
He spat out a flake of precious earth-grown tobacco. Those stogies of his must have cost 50 UTCs apiece.
The guild would be finished. That's all there is to it. At least it would be as a workable alternative for the average independent Starrigger.
He leaned back and shot out an acrid plume of smoke.
Tell me, Jake, why are you still on the road? With your salary as president, why, you could...
Salary? I've heard of the notion. I think I've cashed 2 paychecks so far. The third's still in the glove box, where it goes bouncy, bouncy, bouncy. Red was surprised.
Really? I didn't know.
Besides, there's Sam. I couldn't very well sell my own father, could I? Red didn't comment, just looked at his cigar. Something thin with watery blue eyes was tapping me on the shoulder. One of Wilkes's gunsels.
Mr. Wilkes would like to see you, if you please, sir.
Red coughed once and looked at his watch.
Jake, I'd stay, but we gotta roll. I don't think he'll give you any trouble here.
Sure, Red. Sure. See you around.
Wilkes's table was over against the far wall. Besides him and the Rikki-Tikki, there were 3 gunsels, including the one who'd fetched me. I didn't like the odds, but it was unlikely that Wilkes would start anything in a crowded restaurant, or so I thought.
I tend to think too much.
He was playing with the last few crumbs of an omelet, smiling at me,
those curious gray teeth sliding around behind thin lips. He had a way of working his mouth constantly, a tic, I believed. He wasn't an unattractive man. Long blonde hair, broad features, eyes of cold green fire, all mounted on a powerful frame. A natty dresser as well. His Kelly green velvet jerkin was tailored and was in fact very tasteful, going especially well with the white puffed sleeve blouse.
"Jacob, Jacob, Jacob,"
he sang wistfully, still smiling.
"Good to see you, Jake. Have a seat. Get him a seat, Brucey."
"No thanks, Corey," I told him. Brucey had made no move. "I'll stand. What's on your mind?"
"Why, nothing."
Surprised innocence. He was good at it, but he overplayed it a bit. Was he nervous?
"Nothing at all. Just enjoying a good meal in a good restaurant. A little disappointed when you and your lady friend didn't join us, that's all. You really should observe more of the social amenities, Jake. Oh, I realize your diamond in the rough sort of charm goes a long way, especially with women. But when you see a friend across the room when you're dining out, well..."
He was gracious in dismissing the matter.
"But I don't take offense easily. You're probably in a hurry, right? Behind schedule?"
"I don't like looking at vomit when I eat, that's all." It didn't ruffle him. He grinned through the rather indelicate hiatus in the conversation, then said implacably,
"You have a certain directness of expression that I admire, Jake, but that remark was a bit too blunt, don't you think? But, man, I should know better than to try and stroke you."
"Was that what you were doing?"
"Oh, twitting you a little, I'll be honest. But I really do want to talk, Jake. I think we should, finally."
"Why, whatever about?" It was my turn to be catty.
"Shoes and ships, Jacob."
He waved to the far reaches of the universe.
"Things. Things in general."
"Uh-huh. But out of the totality of existence, there must be something specific."
"Absolutely right."
The constant smile turned extraordinarily benevolent.
"Sure you won't sit, Jake?"
"Forget it."
"Fine."
He lit a small, thin cigarette wrapped in paper of bright pink, blew smoke toward me. The aroma was sweet, perfume-like.
"What say we merge our respective outfits?"
"That's right.
Don't drop your jaw too low, Jake. The busboys will use it as a dustpan. Starriggers Guild and Transcolonial Association of Truck Owner Operators. Together. Hyphenate 'em, or come up with a new name. I don't care. Why continue the war any longer? It's unprofitable, destructively competitive, and frankly, I'm rather tired of it."
The smile was gone, replaced by honest concern.
"A marriage is what I'm proposing."
"Why, Corey, this is so sudden." His face split again.
"You know, you're not as rough around the edges as you let on, Jacob. Whenever we get together, I kind of enjoy the repartee. The parry, the riposte, the barbs lovingly honed."
He blinked.
"But I'm serious."
I stood there, debating whether I should just spit and walk away or go through the motions with him. I couldn't figure out why he was doing this.
"Excuse me, Mr. Jake,"
the reticulan trilled through his mandibles.
"I wonder if I could inquire as to the identity of the female person with whom you are associating."
"What's it to you, Aunt Face?" I find it difficult, if not impossible, to read an alien visage for emotions. Apparently, the insult had had no effect, but I couldn't be sure. I had never before dealt with Rickies. The mandibles kept clicking in and out in that unnerving sewing machine motion. Reticulans don't really look like ants, don't even have bug eyes. You would swear that they wore glasses shaped like a set of zoom camera lenses, and you'd be right, except that they can't take them off. But Rickies do appear insectoid at first glance, being exoskeletal. Who knows? Maybe all Reticulans aren't bad. To be fair, it doesn't help that their appearance happens to resonate with images of chitinous horror that scrabble around in the basement of our racial unconscious. The question, however, was, why was Wilkes presenting me, if indeed he was, with this being? To threaten me? Did he actually think I'd be scared? Give in? Why now, after all this time? No, Wilkes said gently. We don't want an interplanetary incident. I'm sure Twirl's question was all in innocence. Did you recognize her, Twirl?
Precisely. I did not mean to imply an interest in the female person. If I have broken some taboo, is this correct? If I have violated some taboo by inquiring, I am very sorry.
Did everyone know the waif but me? The alien knew exactly what he was doing. Okay, I said testily. About this merger.
There, you see. Paranoia, Jake. Paranoia. It kills us all in the end. We think ourselves into an early grave. Worry, fear, the etiological root of all disease.
Two beats. Then, again, about this merger.
What would it hurt to consider it? Think it over. Stubborn as you are, you've finally got to admit to yourself that the Guild is on borrowed time. More and more drivers are coming back over to us.
A lie. Everyone with a notion to break and run had done so long before. But he was right in the sense that there were damn few of us left.
They've added up the pros and cons. Come to final tally, Wilkes went on. TATOO's better for them all around. A dozen new signatories to the revised basic contract this month, with more to come. Oh, sure, the terms of the Guild's basic are a little better in some areas, I'll grant you that. But it doesn't mean very much when you can count the Guild's signatories on six fingers.
Five, I corrected him. Combined Hydran Industries reneged and went over to you last week. Wilkes rested his case with a casual motion of the hand.
Need I say more?
I certainly had no need to say more. I was watching the faces of the three stooges, looking for clues. The one who had come for me looked antsy, darting eyes around the room. From that, I got the hint that something could be up. It still seemed unlikely. Wilkes had been waiting for me to respond, gave it up, and said,
Oh, come on, Jake. The Guild is nothing more than a shell, if it was ever anything more. Can't you see? It's served its purpose. You've shown me the reservoir of discontent among the membership, and we're responding, believe me. Have you read the revised basic? I mean, have you really sat down and gone over it, clause by clause?
I don't have much time for light reading, I'm afraid. A point scored, an acknowledgement via an upward curl of one end of his mouth.
You really should, he said quietly.
What's in it for me? I asked, sailing with the wind just for the hell of it. It genuinely surprised him.
Well, he said with an expansive shrug, interlocal business agent? For life? Name the salary.
It was a hasty improvisation, and he waited for my reaction.
Hell, Jake, I don't know. What do you want?
For you to bloody well leave us alone. It's that simple.
I erased that with a swipe of my hand. Pardon me, it's not that simple anymore. You're going to answer for Marty DeFlippo, Wilkes. If I have to scrape myself off the side of a cylinder and come back to do it, I will. But I will make you answer for her. And for the others. Conversations lulled at nearby tables.
Okay, Jake. Okay.
His voice was colorless, small. I backstepped twice, but stopped.
One more thing. If the guild is doomed anyway, why are you so hot to mate with us?
I wanted an answer.
Why, Corey?
Because it annoys me.
I suspect it was his first ingenuous remark of the whole exchange. Amused by the novelty, he continued.
Your recent attempts at retaliation annoy me too.
What? This was news.
You're denying it? Don't insult my intelligence, Jake. I've had loads lifted, rigs sabotaged, deals queered. Nothing major, you understand, but it irks me.
I had heard about the recent increase in hijackings and the like. I attributed it to freelance Skyway men, as did the media. We had no muscle to bring to bear on him. The injustice of the charge seared the back of my throat.
Jake, you're a strange man, Wilkes went on, resuming his usual inflected, lyrical style. There's a kind of... a certain Heisenbergian uncertainty about you. An elusiveness. Hard to pin you down. We've been having trouble keeping track of your movements recently. I get a report that you're somewhere, then get another that says you were somewhere else entirely at the very same time. A slippery electron, Jake. Difficult to determine both its position and momentum at once. One or the other, but not both. And the stories...
Stories?
The strange tales I've been hearing about you. Fascinating, if they're true. Especially the one about the...
Look, Corey, I said, cutting him off. It's been nice. Really nice. But I'd like to go salvage a meal.
Thanks for the offer. And at my back, I heard...
You'll never get out of Mock City, Jake.
I stopped, turned, and delivered an obscenity. He laughed.
In fact, what makes you think I couldn't take you out right now?
The three gunsels were eye-riveting me.
Don't think you're safe in a public place, Wilkes warned, eyes narrowed to slits. By the way, I own this dump. Silent partner. The help would back me up. Witnesses.
And the customers?
Are you kidding? They'll stampede as soon as you go down.
The restaurant was awfully quiet. Wilkes could have been blustering, but I was worried. They had me if they wanted me.
Corey, I wouldn't put it past you, but it'd be just a bit too messy for your taste.
Hearings, depositions, not your style. I decided to call his bluff, which was the only thing I could do. I turned, but let my peripheral vision sweep behind me, and in doing so, caught movement. The pale-eyed slug was reaching under the table. I spun, but the boy was fast. He had probably had the gun in his lap the whole time. It was leveled at me, and he was grinning. but he didn't fire. My squib was halfway out from under the cuff of my jacket. I dropped, but there was no cover near. Perhaps 3/4 of a second had elapsed when the boy's hand and the gun in it went up in a blue-white ball of flame. The shot had come from across the room. The alien and the other two had delayed reacting, for the sake of form, I supposed. It would have looked better in the report if only 2 combatants had been involved. Besides, their buddy had had me beaten. Now, they pushed the table over and ducked down behind. Everyone in the place thought it an excellent idea. The restaurant exploded as chairs, food, dishes, tables went everywhere. My squib was finally out, having gotten snagged in a fold of my shirt, and I drew a bead on Wilkes's forehead.
Hold it!
Drop him!
2 voices off to the right. I couldn't see who it was. Wilkes suddenly threw up his hands. He still sat there, as if a spectator.
All right,
he yelled. The pale-eyed one was sitting there too. Eyes popped with horror as he watched a gob of melting flesh slither from the charred claw that had been his hand. He started to scream, the whimpering, surprised scream that comes from a sadist unused to the business end of pain. I got up. The place was silent, save for the gunsel's warblings. The alien and the other two rose, the humans with their hands in the air, the reticulan with his forelimbs crossed in front of him, sign of submission. I chanced to look to the right. Tommaso and Chang were down behind chairs, guns drawn and aimed at Wilkes. I backed away toward them.
Nice shooting, I said to Chang.
It wasn't me.
He inclined his head to our rear. I looked back and was astonished to see Darla crouched down, holding a monster of a Walther 20-kilowatt on the proceedings.
All right, people.
I looked around the room. About 4 other people had guns drawn. The man who had spoken was immediately to my left. I knew none of them.
You,
the man said to me.
You leave.
We'll entertain this group while you're doing it.
We'll give you 5 minutes. Then we'll let them go. The humans, that is. The bug, we might fry for lunch.
Thanks. We all backpedaled our way out after Tommaso had poked his head out the front door and yelled that it was clear. In the interim, I got out my key and buzzed Sam, told him to pick us up on the road about a block away. Out in the lot, I thanked Tommaso and Chang, told them their dues were taken care of for the rest of the year.
Hell, we're paid up,
Tommaso complained.
Next year.
Darla and I ducked into the brush bordering the lot. The undergrowth was tangled, but we made it with a little help from Darla's blunderbuss. When we reached the road, Sam was there, and we piled in. 3.
Never figured Wilkes to make a grandstand play like that, Sam said as we searched the hinterlands of Mach City for an out-of-the-way motel. Would have made a martyr out of you.
Just call me Venerable Jake and take my cause to the Pope.
I don't really think he meant to.
His boy got too excited.
Probably. They would have had the exits covered for a genuine ambuscade. Howsoever,
there being only 1 way off this tropical paradise, and that being the Skyway,
it's safe to say they have the exits covered now, Sam said.
A good bet. Anybody still following us? I asked.
Not a soul.
We passed plantations, a power plant, a few lonely residences off the road. There was not much to see besides jungle.
What's this up ahead?
I squinted. Off in the mass of overhanging greenery were little houses nestled in the treetops. It looked like a movie set. A sign by the road. Greystoke Groves. Tree cabins, free total vid, whirlpool jungle lagoon, guided safari tour, reasonable rates, vacancy. Charming. Just the thing for a cozy getaway weekend.
What say, Sam?
All the same to me. I live in a truck.
Heck, you'll miss the safari.
pity.
Wouldn't miss it for the world. Hang on.
There was a large parking lot, which Sam traversed. Without stopping, he plunged the rig into the wall of undergrowth that bordered same. Branches thumped against the bulkhead, creaked, and shattered. Sam kept going, cutting a swath through the jungle. Brightly colored flying critters took wing in our path, screeching in their panic. We hit a hidden ditch and slammed down. The engine whined, groaned, and we were out of it, crashing forward again through a cataract of vinery. Sam, large tree.
I know. Damn. Let me back up.
The rollers crackled to maximum grab and spun.
Double diddly damn. This stuff is wet.
They don't call it a rainforest for nothing. We backed up and whanged against something.
Ouch. Hold on.
After some uncomfortable maneuverings, we tattered our way onward. A centipede-like animal found itself clinging to our forward viewport, much to its chagrin. It extended two sets of antennae, fore and aft, and elongated itself vertically, each end checking out a possible escape route. They decided on up and crawled out of sight. Finally, we came to a crunching halt near the base of a stout tree trunk. Sam cut the engine, and we sat for a while surrounded by chirping, twittering jungle. Presently, Sam asked,
"One of those tree huts near here?"
"I think. Can't really see a thing."
"Well, find the nearest one and see if it's vacant."
"Wait a minute. Is this a clearing up ahead?" "Go forward a few meters." Sam started the engine, eased ahead. We poked through the edge of a paved footpath.
"Come on, Darla," I said. "Take your pack.
Let's look like tourists." The woman in the office was a short, dark-haired woman who spoke incomprehensible English, but her intersystem was as bad as mine. The accent was Spanish, the eyes Oriental, and I took her for a recently arrived Filipina.
20 UTC, please. You have ID?
Yes. I showed her my Alonzo Q. Snurd persona, the duly authorized plastercard of which I keep for the times when I feel like Alonzo Q. Snurd. "This is my life companion," I said, indicating Darla.
"Mr. Misa Snurd? Happy you be here. You got bags?"
"Yes, thank you. By the way, we want that particular cabin," I told her, pointing to the layout on the wall. "We took a walk back there. We hope it's available."
"Number 17? Nice. No one there now. Front?"
The bellhop came in from a back room. It was a squat but powerfully thewed, very hairy anthropoid creature, a native. The species is regarded as borderline sentient by most authorities. It had two large, wide-set eyes that were owl-like, a wet, dark-lipped mouth splitting a short snout, and floppy, long ears. Its feet were splay-toed, hairless, pink, and looked prehensile. Its three-fingered hands had what looked like opposable thumbs on either side. The creature had no tail.
"This cheetah, she take you."
Cheetah grabbed our bags, took the key from the woman, and scurried off through a vine-covered archway that led into a tunnel. We followed her. At the end of the tunnel was an elevator door. It looked conventional, but the shaft, as it turned out, was non-existent. Instead, we found an open-air car faked up to look like logs and sticks. It more than likely had a metal frame. We got on, and it rose into the trees. From the upper platform, we debarked into a maze of sturdy rope bridges with plank walkways leading from tree to tree, cabin to cabin. Ours was bigger than it had appeared from the footpath, but still quite cozy, resting in the crook of three huge structural boughs. Inside, the decor was consistent with the rest of the place, early RKO pictures, Floors, walls, furniture, and everything else were made of the native equivalents of wicker, rattan, and bamboo. I slumped in the Peacock Empire chair and sighed. The Eridani creature darted about, opening shutters, flicking on lights, turning down beds, and plumping pillows, all very briskly, and with far more dexterity than a Terran ape could muster. It was surprising, in a way. More surprisingly, the creature turned to me and spoke. "Huh?" was all I could reply.
"That all, sir? That all?"
Darla? Darla smiled at the creature.
"Is there a gift shop or store here? I need some tissue paper."
"I go get some. You need, I get."
Darla offered her a credit note. Cheetah refused.
"No, no, fui. Soap, towel, Kleenex, fui. No money."
Cheetah left and closed the door quietly.
"Call me Buana," I said, not feeling particularly witty.
"She's cute. I've seen them before, at carnivals and things. They're really very intelligent."
"Hmm. And honest. She could have snagged that tenor."
Darla laughed, scoffing.
"Do you actually think she needs money?"
"Why is she working here?"
That stumped her. I got out Sam's key and buzzed him.
"Sam, we've set up housekeeping."
"How is it?"
I turned on the microcam and panned the room for him.
"As you can see, charming. How are you?"
"I think I'm taking root."
"Seriously, I might need a little more camouflage around my back end. Can you see me from up there?"
I went to the window. Behind the shutters, it was glazed with non-glare material. The cabin was completely sealed from the outside, and many degrees cooler.
"I can't see anything but vegetables."
"How's this? I have my high intensities on."
I saw a glimmer. "There you are. Fine."
"Maybe I'll be all right if I'm that hard to spot."
"What about the hole you left in the scenery back in the parking lot? Suspicious, no? And it leads right to you."
"I was watching the rear view. The stuff seemed to bound back up after we passed. Right now, I can't tell the view ahead from the one behind. This jungle is alive, believe me."
"Bit of luck. Okay. Now, what about our situation? I'm having second thoughts. Should we have made a break for it on the Skyway?"
"Negative, son. Much, much too easy to follow."
"Right. Just thought I'd ask. What next?"
"Well, we know they picked up our trail from the restaurant pretty quickly. I expected that. Not too hard to tail a rig. And we're pretty sure we lost them downtown."
"How sure?"
"Reasonably sure."
"Sam, how did you know about that Din road that followed the edge of the marsh? I didn't think you knew Mach City that well."
"Used to spend a lot of time here. There were these two women I knew, mother and daughter, and I... Well, that's neither here nor there. Anyway, the city council's been squabbling about draining that swamp for years. I knew the idiots hadn't gotten around to it yet."
"Another piece of luck. However, we are stuck here.
For the moment. But if we can sneak over to Ali's garage, we've got a chance. He's an old friend of mine. We hole up at his place, I get that new emulsicoat you've been promising me, plus some other cosmetic changes. Then, with luck, we slip out."
"Risky. We could be spotted going there."
"Sure, but I can't see another way. Would have gone directly there, except we would have had to double back through town to do it. They would have picked us up again easily."
"So we sit here. For how long?"
"Until they get tired of looking, or until they're convinced we got through their net. 4 airy days."
"That's also risky."
"Sure, Wilkes is connected here. Hell, he might even own this place. But have any better ideas?
Not at the moment. Cheetah returned then with Darla's tissue paper. Darla struck up a conversation with her, and they sat down on one of the double beds to chat. Well, I said, I'll let you know if I get a brainstorm.
Right. Leave the key open.
Really, Dad?
Huh? Oh, sorry. Forgot about Darla.
I hadn't. Despite my disinclination to believe in such things, the possibility of a real paradox here loomed large. In fact, if Darla wasn't faking, the paradox was a fact as cold and adamantine as the road metal that had caused it. Will have caused it. But it was hard for me to swallow. On the Skyway, you hear wild stories every day. I've met people who will swear on any amount of holy writ you'd care to put in front of them that one day, out on some lonely stretch of road, they saw themselves coming the other way. Or that they were vouchsafed the paradoxical apparition of a relative who'd passed on the year before. Or that the Skyway man who held up the Stop and Shop off Interstellar 95 last week was in fact their time-tripping doppelganger, not them. Sometimes, reports such as these make the news feeds, as silly season fillers. Up till now, I had thought this was all the credence they deserved. But now, I was confronted with the possible reality of a situation which, according to the commonly accepted version of the way things are supposed to work, was an out-and-out impossibility. My choices were either to accept it as a fact, or to try resolving the contradiction with every measure of rationality at my disposal. But there were problems with the latter option. Aside from waiting until I could catch Darla in a lie, there was little I could do to assure myself she was telling the truth. What were the alternatives? Chinese water torture? Tickle her mercilessly until she fessed up? And just how does one go about tripping up a liar when one has no facts to throw in her path? It seemed I really had but one choice, to accept the paradox as real, until proven otherwise. I was hearing a reprise of a love theme that should have been very familiar. But it was strange and new. Bass ackwards is not the way I like to do things, but paradox does not grant dispensation from its crazy laws. Nor does Skyway. If you ply her paths, you take the risk. You pay the toll. The road builders, whoever and whatever they were, must have realized the consequences of a hyperspatial highway that spans enormous distances instantaneously. They were excellent physicists, consummate engineers, but whether they could have avoided the pathological aspects, interesting, the way scientists choose their words, of such a device is a matter for conjecture, since our knowledge of these matters needs jacking up a quantum or two before we could begin to understand. My task, then, was to find a causal lever to move objects around to my liking in a deterministic system. Estimated chances of accomplishing objective, those of fart pie monsoon. But volition is a delusion we sorely need, a habit we can't break. I had to act. It was necessary for me to lose Darla now in order to gain her later. Lest two Darlas appear where one had gone before. Or something like that. Deadly possibilities loomed. A knock at the door. My squib was out more quickly this time, even though Wilkes would not bother to knock. It was a small Oriental man who wore a crisp straw planter's hat and a loosely fitting vanilla tropical suit. He didn't look friendly, but acted it.
"Excuse me, sir. Have you seen... Aye, there you are. What are you doing here, Cheetah?
Guests. Guests!
Excuse me, sir. She is lazy, always going off somewhere.
Cheetah
got off the bed and scampered toward us, slowed, and slunk past her master, then broke across the small balcony to the rope bridge.
Pardon me, sir. She is harmless, but she will take advantage.
No problem, Mr.
Perez.
Perez? She just got back from an errand for my LC.
Ah. Enjoy your stay. Sir? Madam?
A tip of the hat, and he was gone. I went to the window and watched him cross the bridge. He yelled for Cheetah, cursed her in Spanish. She did not look back, disappearing into the foliage. Darla was behind me, watching over my shoulder.
What did you two talk about? I asked.
Quite a lot. Your question about why she worked here intrigued me, so I asked her.
And?
She stays here because she doesn't have a home. Red space, territory, or what you will. From what I could get out of her, her home was destroyed. There's a jungle clearing project near here, it seems, and what was once her home is now bare earth.
She couldn't move? Find a new spot?
There are millions of square kilometers of jungle left. Most of the planet is virgin still.
No, she couldn't move, nor could her clan, tribe, or whatever. Once such a group, an extended family sort of thing, loses its stamping grounds, it has no life. Extreme territoriality, attachment to one traditional area, probably passed down for generations. Most of the displaced cheetahs work in the city. Not for long, though. They die off very quickly.
You got all this from her?
No, she was very reticent. I've heard about the problem. The colonials are very touchy about it.
She walked back toward the bed, sat down.
Funny thing. She's very sensitive, receptive. She asked me if the people who were chasing us were near.
What?
The notion that the animal could have known gave me an odd feeling. I sat down on the Empire chair.
How?
She said she could smell the fear on us.
Odder still was to realize that Cheetah had been right. At the root of all actions taken for the sake of survival lies fear unvarnished, the basic component of the mechanism.
Did she think they were near?
She said no, not now.
Reassuring.
I'm tired. I think I'll go freshen up.
She got up, took her pack, and walked toward the bathroom.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.